Praise the Lord. We want to welcome every one of you to our English service. God is a good God, and this evening, even as we worship God, I pray that we all will experience a new, fresh touch from God. Let's all join together and worship. The word of the Lord says in Psalm 5:7, "But I, by your great mercy, will come into your house. In reverence will I bow down towards your holy temple. I come to your house, and with your great mercy, God, you will touch me with your great mercy. You will lead me with your great mercy. You will do things in my life." Amen. My dear friends, this evening, you know what we need? We need God. We need His mercy. We need His grace in our life. And you know what? His grace overflows in our life. And God is abound. God is full of His grace. And God will fill us with His grace this evening, with His love this evening, with His strength this evening. Even as we worship, let's say, "God, I need you. I need you. I need you more in my life." Can you go ahead and worship God and say, "God, I need you. I need your presence in my life, oh God. I need you, oh God, in my life." Can you worship God and say, "God, I need you. God, I need you. God, I need your presence in my life." Worship God. Worship God and say, "God, I need your presence. I need you more." Say, "God, I come before you. I bow down before you. You're the only one, oh God, who can guide my heart. Oh Lord, we worship you. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we need you. God, we need you. Jesus, we need you. Oh, Lord, we need you." Somebody worship him and say, "God, we need you. God, we need your presence. God, we need your presence." Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Lord, we need your presence. We need your presence. Somebody praise him. Somebody worship him and say, "God, we need your grace in our life. Only you can guide our hearts. Oh Lord, I need you in the morning. I need you in the noon. Need you in the evening. I need you at all times, oh God. I need you at all the moments in my life. Oh, I need you, I need you, I need you." Sing with us. "Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour, I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need. Sin runs deep, your grace is more, oh God. My grace is found, is where I am. I worship you this evening. Fill me with your grace. Somebody lift your hands and say, "Oh, when sin runs deep, when sin runs deep, your grace is more. Your grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, but I am free. Holiness is Christ in me." Lift it up and say, "Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Here we are. I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need. Oh Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, we need you, oh God. We need you every hour. Every hour. I need you. You're my defense, my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need. Oh God, how I need you." to rise to you. When temptations comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall by you. Jesus, you're my hope, I stay. Somebody say, teach my soul to rise to you. When temptations comes my way, when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Somebody say, Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Area, I need you. My one defense, righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Say, Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Praise somebody, say, Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. At all moments, I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, Lord, I need you. Oh, Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. With all of your heart, can you say, Lord, I love you? Can you say, Lord, I love you? I love you with all of my heart. I love you with all of my soul. I love you with all of my strength. You are lovely, oh God. Can you say, oh, I love you. And this evening it is about you. It is about you. It is about you. We worship you, O God, God of heaven and earth. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. When sin runs deep, your grace is more. And this evening we pray that you would pour out your grace on each and every one of us, O God. We need your strength. We need your mercy, O God. We need your love. We need you, O God. We need you, God. Thank you for the wonderful time of worship we had. We know that you have filled us with your strength, with your power. And this evening, oh God, we come back to you. We come back to you. If any one of you, my dear friends, if you say, I've gone away from God, from his love. And if any one of you say, I'm very weak and tired and lonely, God is for you. Jesus is for you. And he loves you. His love remains the same forever and ever. God, fill each and every one of us with your love. Thank you for the wonderful time we had. But as we listen to your word, oh God, speak to us. Let your name be lifted up and glorified. In your name we ask and pray. Amen, amen, amen.
Praise the Lord. What a joy it is to worship God. We need God at all moments in our life. I believe that you have enjoyed the worship. The song said, Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Every hour I need you. We need God at all moments in our life. Amen. This evening I want to welcome every one of you to our English service. If you are joining new for our service, God bless each one of you. And I truly believe that you're going to enjoy and you're going to learn more about God. And this service is going to help you in spiritually molding yourself and also coming closer to God. Amen. I hope and believe that you are enjoying all our services, and many are commenting, and many are saying that it is a blessing. And this evening, get ready to receive God's word. Keep a book with you, open your Bibles, and as I preach, you want to note down some points. Let's do it. God is going to speak to each one of you through his word. Amen. So you don't have to look around for signs of troubles and problems in this world. Just turn around and you will have a lot of problems. You don't have to look far for some problems or for some troubles. Just look around and you will see a lot of people and a lot of troubles around you. And it is just evident in our life. You open the newspaper, you read the news and watch the news. Troubles, problems are everywhere. Amen. And at this point of time, you know what people search? People search for answers. And people search for a source of power from where they can get that peace, that relaxation. And sometimes people depend on money, they depend on their status, their work, and people depend on bank, their finance, and people depend on the government, and people depend on each other. But you know what? All these things cannot assure them of complete security, some complete confidence. So what people need right now is answers. Answer to all the troubles that they're going through. What people need right now is, you know, what a solution. What people need right now is a peace in their inner self, which money can't give, which their work, which the work that they are doing can't give, which people around them can't give. So they need a strong security. Amen. As we look in one of the Psalm, from the book of Psalm, you know, the author there, the writer there, gives us an answer as how I can be assured that how I can get this peace in me, how I can be assured of the security that I can get. And this psalmist, I'm talking about the psalmist David, as he writes down, as he pens down Psalm 27, he talks about how God is our source of security. He talks about how God is our source of strength during all these times of trouble. My dear friends, this evening, even as we look through Psalm 27, I believe that God is going to enrich you through his word. He's going to talk to you through his word. And from this Psalm, you're going to learn how in midst of all this trouble, how in midst of all this confusion, and how in midst of all the things that we are going through, you will receive strength and you will receive peace. And the psalmist there, psalmist David, understood that it is God who is the source of all the confidence, God who is the source of all hope. And this evening, even you are going to receive and understand that it is God who is our source of help, and God who is the source of our rescue during these times that we are going through. So Psalms have a wonderful capacity to capture the reality of human experiences. So the expression of a common man, it can be our emotions, it can be the things that we feel, it can be our anxieties, it can be our attitude or gratitude. So if you read through Psalms have this capacity to capture human emotions. So even as you read through Psalm 27, I know you can understand how the psalmist is feeling, and he can really connect to our feelings that we are going through. So through Psalm 27, we are going to understand different things of what David is feeling and how David is, you know, confident. And from Psalm 27, we are going to learn a wonderful truth today. Amen. So let's turn our Bible to Psalm 27, verse 1. Verse 1, he goes on to write, "The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear?" It's a question, a rhetorical question. So he already knows the answer. So he's saying, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Amen. He begins by showing personal faith and confidence on God. He is mentioning personal pronoun. The Lord is my light. See, look at what he's saying. He is not saying the Lord is the light. He's saying the Lord is my light. So there's a strong emphasis on personal pronoun. So he's saying the Lord is my light. So it's a personal faith, personal confidence. So he's not talking about, you know, the confidence, looking at confidence what other people had, but he's saying the Lord is my light, and he's saying the Lord is my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Amen. Look at the confidence that the psalmist is having. Psalmist David, he's saying the Lord is my light, the personal experience that he had with God. My dear friends, as we look around things, you know, Bible says in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. So that means chances are there are going to be troubles. I'm not talking about the trouble that we are going through, especially the trouble, the COVID trouble that people are going through. Trouble can come through many ways, many means. It can be anything, your personal life. It can be finances. It can be, troubles can be of different types. In those situations, what are you saying? What are you praying? Okay, now psalmist is writing, so probably I don't know what kind of situation he was going through. Different scholars say, you know, he was writing this when he was having trouble with Saul. Different people say he was writing this after he had become king and after he had succeeded all those things, and he was relaxing and writing this. But we don't know when he wrote, but during the time that he was writing, he had some kind of things going on in his mind, or he had many experiences, psalmist David. So he says, the Lord is my light. If I want to ask you a question, what would you say? What would you say? What is God to you? Okay, for Psalmist David, it was God was his light. God was his salvation. And he's saying, why should I fear? Now, many people right now, you know what they have? They have fear. I was talking to my friend, you know, he's from Nepal. He said, you know, the people who died with corona are very less compared to the people who have died in fear. He said, many people have committed suicide because of fear, job loss, and they have nothing to do. So they have that fear in them. So they committed suicide. Look at what fear can do. Fear can kill a person. Fear can destroy a person. Fear can tell a person that he or she is nothing in this world. Fear can say to a person that he cannot accomplish what he is planning. Fear will put a person down. Fear will kill a person, as I was telling you earlier. Fear, we need to overcome our fear. So psalmist says, if I want to overcome the fear, you know what, I should understand who God is to me. As I told in the beginning, if I'm looking at all the means around me, if I'm saying money is going to help, my friends are going to help, they can help, but not up to an extent. My dear friend, let me tell you, complete help, complete confidence, complete victory comes from God alone. And we need to understand this truth. And psalmist David clearly understood, you know, my complete help, my complete victory is from God. If I want to triumph in my life, it should be only from God. Amen. Are you understanding this truth this evening? If you want to triumph in your life, if you want to completely win over situations in your life, you need to have God in your life. Amen. That is the truth. The truth is, you need God at all point of your life. And who is God to you this evening? For David, God was, you know, a light. He was salvation. Light meaning, you know, he understood God was light. What does light do? You know, light shows us the way. Light gives us confidence. Light gives us hope. You know, light shows us where we are going, what we are doing. He understood God is my light. Amen. Light signifies his hope and confidence. And when light is there, there is no place for darkness. Many people's lives are filled with darkness. They say, brother, I'm trying to do this, I'm trying to do that, but I'm not experiencing something nice. I'm doing the same thing again and again. I'm seeing darkness in me. Sin is, you know, overcoming me. Situations are taking control of me. What? I don't know, what should I do? Many people are living in darkness. There are many things running in your mind. I'm trying to do this. Many people say, I am trying to commit suicide. I want to end up, I want to give up. My dear friend, understand who is the light. Jesus is the light. And he says, I'm the light of this world. When you have Jesus in you, when you have understood Jesus as your light, let me tell you, there is no place for, amen, darkness. Amen. You heard it very clear. There is no place for darkness. He says, the Lord is my salvation. The Hebrew understanding of salvation is, the Lord is my deliverer. The Lord is the one who rescued me. The Lord is the one who saved me. That is the understanding of salvation. And David says, the Lord is my salvation. Come on, who is God to you? God has saved you from all the troubles that you are going through. And right now, if you are saying, brother, I'm having a lot of troubles, understand what God has done in your past. And he is all capable to guide you. He is all capable to lead you. He is all capable to mold you. He is all capable to take you out of all these things that you are going through. Somebody say amen. God is my salvation. And he's saying a rhetorical question, whom should I fear? Whom shall I fear? No, I don't have to fear to anyone. I don't have to fear to the situation that is happening around us. I don't have to fear to my enemies. He's saying, I have a lot of enemies, but I will not fear. Why? Because God is my light. If God is my light, you know, I don't have to worry about anything. Then he says, the Lord is my stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? He says, God is my stronghold, a place where I can go hide, a place where I can go take refuge. You know, God is that place to you, my dear friends. God is your stronghold. Stronghold is a place where you can go and be safe in that place. Stronghold is the place where you can go and save yourself from all the things that is happening around you. And you know who is your stronghold? God is your stronghold. And you don't have to be afraid. Somebody say amen. there is no fear, there is no afraid. When you understand that God is your light, God is your salvation, and God is your stronghold. David understood this very clearly. Amen. Why should I fear? Proverb 18 says, in Proverb 18 we read, the name of the Lord is strong tower. The righteous run into it and is safe. The name of the Lord is strong tower. Somebody say strong tower. Somebody say name of the Lord. When you call on the name of the Lord, you know what? You are calling on the one who has created heaven and earth. When you are calling on the name of the Lord, you know what? You are calling on somebody with whom you can rely on, with whom you can depend on, with whom you can trust on. Come on, somebody say amen. The name of the Lord is strong tower. As you call on the name of the Lord, you know whom you are calling? You are calling somebody with whom you can really believe and trust in. Amen. The name of the Lord is strong tower. Romans 8 we read, if God is for us, who can be against us? Who can be against us? God is for you. But the point is, what have you understood about God? David has understood God very clearly. Amen. I mean, David, why was David so confident? He was so confident to tell all these words. You know why? David's confidence came out from all his experiences. You know the first three kings of Israel. You know who is the first three kings? Saul was the first king. David was the second king. And David's son, Solomon, was the third king. Look at all these three kings' life. You know, Saul came from a background. You know, he was actually a wealthy man. So he did not have to worry about so much. You know, he had a good life and then he became a king. So he was a man, tall, strong, and his family was really good, wealthy family. So Saul was really good, and then he was having a wonderful life, and then he became the king. So not much difference. See, look at Solomon, David's son. Solomon also, when he was born in the palace. He was rich, so he was there growing, and then he became the king. So both Saul and Solomon did not have to face many problems in their life. But look at David's life. David, you know, he was a shepherd. He was just there gazing the sheep, and he was singing some worship song. Then Samuel wanted to anoint Jesse's family, his father's family, as one person as a king. You know, David's father did not even consider David. You look at the shame. I mean, look at the pity of David. He did not even consider David. He said, that boy is somewhere there, okay, he's doing something with the sheep. I think he does not fit to be a king. Little did Jesse know that he's going to become the king. My dear friend, David was not even considered. Sometimes, you know, even in our lives, it can be you. Your parents may not consider you. They will think this boy is not fit for anything. They may say, your friends may say, this boy, I don't know what he's going to do. He has failed in his studies. Work is not happening properly. He is not obedient to the family. I think he is fit for nothing. If people are saying something against you, don't worry about all those things. What people tell doesn't matter. God has planned something in your life. People were talking so many things. Jesse, David's father, was talking so many things. It did not matter. God had planned David to be the king. What God planned, it happened. Look at the experience. And after Samuel has anointed David as the king, you know, he did not get the crown. He had to go through a lot of situations. Saul was, you know, after David to kill him. You know, David would have thought in his life, why God, why me? I was simply there worshipping you, singing some songs and having a good relationship with you. But why? You know, I don't know. David would have asked all these questions. He went through a lot of experiences. My dear friend, if God had planned something in your life, it will happen. Look at David's experience. I mean, the reason why he's so confident, you know why? Because the experience that he had with God. If you are having some tough experience in your life, let me tell you, you are growing to be a better man. You are growing to be a better human being in this world. And you are, as you are triumphing a lot of things in your life, let me tell you are becoming a different person, a strong person. Amen. Somebody shout an amen. Let us keep going. And verse 4 is a fantastic verse. It says, one thing. What is that? One thing. I mean, when I pray, you know, I have so many things in my mind when I pray. When you pray, you have so many things in your mind. You can keep praying for so many things. But David says, you know what he says? I have so many things to pray. I have so many things in my mind. I have so many enemies around me. But you know what? He says one thing. What is that? He says one thing. Wow. If you can sit deep and understand what is he trying to say. Come on, David, you have so many things to say and God is listening to your prayer. Say all the things that you are worrying with. Say all the things that is disturbing you. Talk about all the enemies. Talk about all the problems that you are having in your life. David says, no. I have just one thing. And you know what is that one thing? That one thing is not the big problem that he has in our life.
If God is asking you, what is that one thing that I want to do in your life? You will say, the big problem that you have in your life. You know what, David, tell some big problem that you have in your life. When you are saying about one thing, you know what? I don't want to talk about my problem. I don't want to pray about my problem. You know what David is saying? One thing I ask from the Lord, you know what it is? It is, God, solve me this big problem. No, that this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. I mean, David, are you gone crazy? You have so many problems with you. You have so many situations around you. Talk about all your problems. You know what David is saying? No, I don't have to talk about my problem because he knows my problem. My dear friend, right now what you and me need is, you know what? God's presence. And David understood very clearly. I have so many things around me, but God, one thing what I need, that I want to stay in your presence. He says, I want to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, and to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. Oh, come on, somebody say amen. Somebody clap your hand and say amen. One thing what David wanted, to seek him and to stay in his house. My dear friend, look at the prayer of David. Look at what he's praying for. What are you praying this evening? Tell me, who is bigger? Is God bigger or the problems is bigger? Tell me, what do you want to talk to God? Do you want to tell all your problems to God? Or do you want to exalt God with all the wonderful words and worship and just want to praise God? What do you want to do this evening, even as you're listening to this message? David understood very clearly, my problems can be very big, situations can be very big, but you know, God, what I need right now is only one thing. I just want to stay in your presence. I just want to come to your house. I just want to dwell in your presence. I just want to look at your presence. I just want to pray, oh God. I just want to be in your presence. That is the only thing that I need. My dear friends, what do you need this evening? You know, do you think God is smaller than all your problems? No, God is bigger than all your problems. He's bigger than all your situations. He's bigger than all your circumstances. The only thing that we need right now is, no, you know what? Staying in God's presence. You know, David was living in such a time, you know, before David, when Samuel was there, you know, we see in Samuel chapter 3 verse 1, it says, the boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. See, during the time of Samuel, there were no much visions. The word of the Lord was very rare. We are living in such a times where people say, young people doesn't pray. Young people don't spend time in God's presence. Young people spend much time on other things. My dear friend, we'll have to break all those ideas what people are having on us. Young people, they say, young people, no, they don't listen to God. They don't listen to the word of the Lord. They don't listen to advices. Young people don't pray. They don't stay in the presence of God. We have all kinds of talk around us. I think we should break all those kinds of talks. And we should tell people, that young people, that this generation, they say this generation, say this generation is a generation where they are seeking God. We need a generation who will call on the name of upon God. During the time of Samuel, the word of the Lord was rare. We need a generation who will sit in the presence of God, do nothing, just sit and say, God, I need you. How many times have you spent time in the WhatsApp doing nothing, just scrolling on the messages, watching this, watching that, doing that, and you see the time, 1 hour has passed, 2 hours has passed. We do nothing, we simply waste our time. We need a generation who will sit under the presence of God and say, God, I need you. Who will sit under the presence of God and say, God, I don't want to pray for anything. I just want to sit in your presence and I want to long for you, oh God. I want to look at your beauty. Moses said, God, I want to see your glory. My dear friend, what are you longing for this evening? Look at David's confidence. Look at the prayer that David prayed. God, one thing that I want from you. You know what? I just want to sit in your presence. Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah. Somebody praise the Lord. Amen. This generation should be a generation where we will see God. No, I see some people, you know, we don't do anything in our lives. You know, reading the word or prayer, or nothing happens in our life. But when situation comes, we run after God. We want instant solution. You know, we want instant things to happen in our life. No, it doesn't work like that, my dear friend. You need to consistently, you know, be under God's presence, be under his shelter and say, God, I need you at all moments in my life. He said, I have thousands of problems around me, but one thing I need is your presence, God. Can you pray that prayer this evening? Oh, come on, somebody say amen. Mary was there under the feet of Jesus. Martha was worried about so many things. God said, no, look at Mary. She just needs one thing. And she is doing that thing that she wants. She is under my feet. And that is what Mary wants and that is what she needs. Martha, you are worried about so many things. My dear friends, are we worried about so many things around us? You know, only one thing that we need. You know what? We need the feet of Jesus. We need the presence of Jesus. We need to come in God's presence and say, God, I have so many things around me, but the only thing that I need right now is your presence. That is what David did. Amen. The secret of David's confidence was his private obedience. Write down in your book. The secret of David's confidence was his private obedience. He took time to fellowship with the Lord and to get direction from him. David knew that the most important part of his life was the part that only God could see. The important part of your life, you know what is that important part? That important part is what God could see. Amen. Somebody say an amen. Let's keep going. He says in verse 11, he says, teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Teach me your way. Look at the prayer David is praying. He's confident. He says, I want to be in your presence. And you know what he's praying? He's not praying, God, how shall I do this? Solve me this problem. Solve that particular problem. You know what he's saying? Teach me your way. And he's saying, lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Teach me. Look at the prayer. We need to pray. Amen. I have wonderful quotes of these prayers. You know, he say Oswald said like this, we have to pray with our eyes on God, not on our difficulties. I'll repeat. We have to pray with our eyes on God, not on our difficulties. Amen. Amen. Somebody say amen. I have so much to do that I shall spend the first 3 hours in prayer. You know who said this? Martin Luther. He said, I have so many things to do, but I want to spend my first 3 hours, you know where? In prayer. Teach me your way. Many people are saying, I don't know what to do. Yes. Yes, you don't know what to do. You know, the best thing to do is ask God what to do. Amen. Because he will tell you what to do. Amen. I don't know where to go. Okay, you don't know where to go. That's okay. Ask God, where should I go? I don't know how to overcome the situations. Yes, you don't know how to overcome the situations. Ask God. He will tell you how to do it. Amen. Somebody shout an amen. Amen. Oswald Chambers said this, prayer does not fit us for the greater work. Prayer is the greater work. Somebody say an amen. What a wonderful quote. It says, prayer does not fit us for the greater work. Prayer is the greater work. If you are praying, my dear friend, if you are dedicating your time for prayer, let me tell you, you are doing a greater work. Some people say, I want to do some great work, so let me pray. No, no, no. When you pray, that is the greater work. Hallelujah. David said, I want to be in your presence. Next is saying, God, teach me your way. He's praying unto God and saying, God, teach me your way. Let me go straight. He's saying, there are so many things in my path, but I want to walk straight, oh God. If I want to walk straight, I need your presence. My dear friend, we need God's presence. Amen. We need God's guidance. We need the power of the Holy Spirit for us to walk straight in our life. Things that is happening around us and things that is going to happen, oh, we don't know. We don't know, but we can be confident that in anything that is happening in my life, I know God is in complete control. Somebody shout an amen. Verse 14 says, wait for the Lord, be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. David, he's so confident when he came to God. And he knows, he's saying, I want to stay in the presence of God. He's saying, God, teach me, what should I do? Now, you know what he's saying? I will wait for the Lord. I will wait for the Lord. I will be strong and I will take heart. Wait for the Lord. My dear friend, wait for the Lord. Wait. Instead of rushing ahead, David calmly waited on the Lord. Because faith and patience goes together. Listen to this carefully. If you are having a lot of faith, if you are listening to the word and having faith in you and saying, God, I want to move forward, be patient. Because faith and patience will go together. David did not rush. He said, God, I want to be in your presence. Okay, do this thing for me. God, I'm staying in your presence. I want to dwell in your presence. I want to seek you. I want to be with you. Okay, let this problem be over. David's saying, okay, all these things are there. Okay, but I will wait on the Lord. I will be strong. So with the waiting period, I will try to be strong. Look at the prayer that David is praying. Look at the conclusion that he is giving in Psalm 27. Wait on the Lord and be strong. My dear friend, don't rush the things that you're doing. Don't rush. Wait on the Lord. And he is going to give you the right thing at the right time. Amen. Scottish preacher, he said like this. Let us be watchful after the victory as before the battle. Some people prepare for the battle very well. But after the battle, when they are won the victory, you know, they don't think much about after the victory. When they were thinking much about before the battle. You know what he said? Let us be watchful after the victory as before the battle. We need to be watchful at all times. I have overcome a situation. After that, be watchful. I'm overcoming certain things, be watchful. Today I've spent time with God. Okay, after that, be watchful. And again, Take time to spend time with God. Take time, plan. When should I sit under the presence of God? Plan. When should I pray? Plan. When should I read the word? Plan. Plan and spend time with God. Consistency matters, my dear friend. Every day, the time that you spend with God really matters. I cannot go one day and say, God, I need you, but spend the rest of the days, rest of the week doing nothing with God. And again, I come and say, God, I need you. No, it doesn't happen. Every day, you should be consistent in spending time, especially when the time that you are winning the battle, when the time that you are triumphing. After that, don't relax. Spending time with God, being in the presence of God, it should be consistent. It should go throughout in your life. Somebody say amen. David is saying, I will wait patiently for the Lord. I will stay strong. My dear friend, I remember this song by one of this famous writer. He says, I know not what the future hold, but I know who holds the future. Amen. I'll tell again. I know not what the future hold, but I know who holds the future. I don't know what is going to happen in my future, but I know who is taking control of my future. Somebody say amen. This evening, what are you learning from Psalm 27? The Psalm is David. You know, he's correctly bringing out the emotion, what a common man feels. He's saying, God, why should I fear? When you are the light, why should I fear? When you are the salvation, why should I fear? When you are the stronghold, why should I fear? For whom should I be afraid? Look at the personal experience that he had with God. He's saying, why should I? Come on, I want you to say this. I will never fear. Say this. Lord, you are my light. Say that you are my light. Say, Lord, you are my salvation. Say, Lord, you are my stronghold. I will never fear. Say, I will never be afraid. Somebody say amen. One thing I ask of the Lord, that I would dwell in the house of the Lord and I would gaze on his beauty all the days of my life. Look at his prayer. Look at his prayer. And he's saying, teach me, Lord. Teach me. Who can teach me? Can Google teach me? Can my friends teach me? Can all the social networking teach me? No. They will lead me to the wrong path. But God, you teach me. Your ways are perfect. Somebody say amen. You know what he's saying at the end? I will wait patiently for the Lord. You know, I have prayed. I am confident. I'm staying in the presence of God. And I've asked God to lead me the straight way. But you know what I'm doing right now? I'm going to wait patiently for the Lord. My dear friend, as you wait patiently along with the faith, let me tell you, God is going to do wonderful things in your life. And God is going to do things that he has planned in your life. Don't you worry. Don't your heart be troubled. Because the God whom we worship, he has overcome the world. And we have the same power in us. And that power that God has installed in us, you know, it is the same power that Jesus has resurrected. You know, we have the power of Jesus in us. The same resurrection power lives in us. You know, as David said, God, there are so many things I can pray for, but I want to just pray for one thing. I just want to be in your presence. Can you pray that prayer this evening and say, God, if I had to pray right now for different things, I have a big list, but I don't want to pray for all those lists. I just want to pray one prayer. Pray saying, God, I just want to be in your presence. Can we be that generation where we can say, I want to sit in the presence of God. I want to listen from the presence of God. I want to just be in the presence of God and receive from God. I want to look at his beauty. I want to see his glory. Nothing else I need, Lord. I just need you. Can you be that generation where you say, God, I just need you? Because you know who God is. God is love, and he loves you, you know, and he wants us to be in his presence, and he wants us to understand him. Sometimes the things of the world will pull us away from God. My dear friend, this evening it's a call to you. Come closer to God. Have you gone away far from God? Have you gone away far from the presence of God? Are you gone away far from the love of God? This is the call to you. Come closer to God's love. David would say, God, I will not fear. Is fear entangling you? Is fear is there in your heart? I pray right now, God, remove all the fear. Remove all the anxiety. Let no one be afraid. Let you understand that God is your light. He is your salvation. He is your stronghold. And say, God, the only thing that I need is I want to come to your presence. And say, God, teach me your way. And say, God, no matter what, I am ready to wait. I am ready to wait patiently. And I'm not going to be afraid. And I'm going to wait very strong, oh God. My dear friend, if you have heard the word, give your life to God once again. Say, God, I want to recommit my life once again into your hands. And say, God, I have prayed for a lot of things, but the only thing that I need right now is your presence, God. Is your presence. I want to long for your presence. Can you be that person? Have you gone through different experience in your life? My dear friend, God is watching you. God is taking care of you. God is controlling your life. Say, God, I once again come to your presence and I want to seek you. Can you close your eyes and pray? As we sang in that song, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you, oh God. Every moment I need you in my life. My dear friend, are you that person who is afraid? Are you that person who is, you know, disturbed with a lot of things that is happening around you? My dear friend, God has spoken to you very clearly. God loves you and God wants you to overcome all the things that you're going through. Right now, I want you to just close your eyes and pray the prayer that David prayed. David said, Lord, you are my light. And Lord, you are my salvation. You are my stronghold. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? And David said, Lord, one thing that I ask of you, that I would dwell in the house of you, O God. I would gaze on your beauty forever and ever. And David said, Lord, show me your way. Show me your way. And that is my prayer. My dear friend, pray this prayer. And say, God, I will wait patiently for you. I will wait strong, O God. No matter what is happening around me, I will never be afraid. I will never be shattered because the one whom I love, the one whom I believe, the one whom I hope on, he is there in me and he's going to guide me and he's going to lead me and he's going to take me, oh God, and he's going to help me to overcome all the things that I'm going through. I don't know what the future holds, but I know who holds my future. God holds my future. Jesus holds my future. Thank you, oh God. Thank you. I pray this generation will be a generation who will seek your face. Who will not seek anything else, oh God, but who would seek your face, who would stay in your presence, and who would long for your presence, oh God, who would long for your touch. God, I pray right now, you will touch everyone who are listening to the word, oh God. We would be that generation who would seek you, who would just stay in your presence, say, God, we need you. Come to the feet of Jesus and say, God, I need you. The feet of Jesus is the strongest place. The presence of God is the strongest place. God, I pray that we would long for your presence. We would seek your presence and we would need your presence, oh God. Everyone who is listening right now, I pray that we would have a stronger desire to come to your presence or to get closer to your presence, oh God. In Jesus' name I pray. If anybody is having fear, if anybody is afraid, if anybody is having anxieties, if anybody is having a negative thoughts in them, if anybody is having thoughts of giving up their life, giving up hope, oh God, I pray against all the things that they are going through. I pray in Jesus' name that you will remove all the anxieties, that you will remove all the fear, oh God. I pray that you will remove all the hopelessness in Jesus' name. If anybody is saying life is over, I'm gonna end up my life, I pray against all the spirits in Jesus' name. I pray that they would overcome in Jesus' name. Take complete control, oh God. Thank you for blessing us with your word. Thank you, oh God. Your word has enlightened us. Your word has touched us, oh God. And your word has given us the revelation. The only thing that we need right now is your presence. And help us to seek you. Seek you with all of our heart. Seek you with all of our soul. Seek you with all of our mind. Oh God, we need you. We need your presence. Thank you for this wonderful time that we had, oh God. We know that you have touched us with your word. Take complete control. Let your name be lifted up and glorified. In your name we ask and pray. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Amen. What a God we worship. And this evening, I truly believe that you were empowered with God's word. Come on, let me tell you, God's word, when it is there in us, no one can shake us. Amen. Thank you. Amen. Have a wonderful week ahead. If it was a blessing for you, then don't forget to share to somebody who will really need it. Amen. God bless each and every one of you. We will meet next week. God bless us all. Amen.